Welcome to AeroSpaceNews.com. I'm glad you made the hyperspace jump to our humble quadrant of the galaxy. This is an exciting episode with our first of hopefully many interviews with astronomer Lauren Biddle. So please stay in orbit because the show starts right after this. Welcome to our channel's first interview or hangout. Our guest today is a newly minted astronomer who is embarking on a career as an exoplaneteer. I hope you'll be as thrilled as I am to have her join us today to share that experience, discuss astronomy, new discoveries, and a lot of other cool things. Please welcome to the AeroSpaceNews.com crew, Lauren Biddle. Lauren, welcome to AeroSpaceNews.com.
Hey.
Where are you joining us from today?
So I'm actually currently in Hilo, Hawaii.
I see.
Really great. Yeah, it's absolutely amazing here. I'm really, really happy to be here.
And were you always in Hilo, Hawaii, or did you start your academic astronomy career thingy somewhere else?
Astronomy career thingy. That's pretty much how it feels. In the best way possible. So I started out at the University of Arizona is where I got my bachelor's in science in astronomy and physics. And that was a really great experience. And I knew that after that I wanted to keep going. So I plan to go on to grad school and get my PhD in astronomy. Currently at the moment, I'm kind of in limbo between undergrad and grad school. I'm taking a year off to do some research, which is why I'm here. I am at Gemini Observatory, and I am participating in an internship. And it's been a really great experience, not only just being on the island, but we even got to go up to the telescopes and work with really great data. So that's what I'm doing right now and where I plan to go.
Now, you kind of phoned in college, if I remember correctly from our background. It was something like advanced basket weaving and something else, or did I remember that wrong?
Wait, pardon, what?
You actually had a double major, didn't you?
Yes, advanced basket weaving, that's where it came in. A double major in astronomy and physics, and I have to say a lot was learned, and not only in astronomy and physics, but more just how to be an astronomer or a physicist, which was really great. Yeah. And I feel like the U of A was a really great place to do that as well because of the access to the telescopes that we have. I even had the opportunity to operate my own telescope, which I'm not sure if many other institutions have one just readily available, even for undergrads to use. So. I learned a lot about what it's like to be an astronomer, and it was good after I had gotten my degree that I still felt like I wanted to do it, which I can't speak for everyone, but I'm not sure if that's the case for everyone.
It sounds like you've been very blessed to be able to find something that you thought you were going to be passionate about, and after being exposed to it, I'm sure as intensely as you were exposed to it in school. The schooling you've done so far, that you still found that you were passionate for it. So really good for you. Congratulations.
Thanks. Yeah. And the particular subjects that I would like to pursue would be exoplanets. I had the opportunity as an undergrad to do my own research on exoplanets. And I had mentioned earlier being able to operate telescopes, and the reason that I was not only obtaining data for other astronomers, but I got to lead my own observational campaigns, which was really cool. And these were of exoplanets, exoplanet transits, to, specify which kind of exoplanet data we were obtaining. So I think that that's the path that I would like to continue on. But I do have other interests as well. For example, my current research here at Gemini is active galactic nuclei, which is something that I haven't worked with at all. And I think that's what makes it more exciting, is that maybe I don't know nearly as much about it, which is why I wanted to do this internship. And I'm learning a lot of skills that can be applicable to other kinds of research, such as exoplanets.
And you've got, you refer to yourself as an intern, but you've actually got a pretty rad title, don't you?
Oh, yes. The rad title would be Exoplaneteer.
Well, there's that, but also at Gemini, aren't you something, don't you have like a driver-like title as well? Aren't you a telescope something or other? Telescope operator? No?
Oh, no, not here. No, not at Gemini.
That was back at in Arizona.
Yes.
Ah, okay. My bad. Senior moment.
No, it's okay. So, I can see how that would be.
Just to take a moment and remind our audience about two very important details that you've just brought up. One, that the whole science of astronomy probably really wouldn't be possible, at least not with the knowledge that we have right now, without the understanding we have of the laws of physics. Is that not correct? Did physics and that double major that you so amazingly achieved, did that play a role in enhancing your ability to do the astronomy work?
Oh, certainly. Yeah, astronomy basically is physics. And I think as an undergrad, as a freshman, really, an incoming freshman, I had the opportunity to speak with an advisor at the astronomy department. And I went in not really knowing that there was so much physics involved. I knew what I knew about Hubble, being able to take amazing, beautiful pictures. And I knew that I really was amazed by these celestial objects that just blew my mind. And I think I was caught up in the romantic aspect about astronomy. And I'm not at all disappointed by any means about the physics aspect, because I'm also mind blown by physics. So it's kind of a win-win. But I definitely learned that you definitely need physics to do astronomy. And to accomplish the major, there really weren't too many extra requirements to have both majors on your degree. You did have to take a lot more labs and more advanced physics courses, but I mean, that's not a bad thing. More to apply later on.
So, really cool. So one of the lessons here is kids, stay in school.
You could say that, yeah. Stay in school, maybe learn in school. No, you can stay in school and you can not pay attention. Actually, sometimes not paying attention isn't necessarily a bad thing. For example, it depends on how you're not paying attention. I found myself sometimes sitting in astronomy classes and thinking of physics concepts that could be applied to astronomy situations, and they weren't totally related, but if I were an astronomy major alone, then I might not have been able to make that connection that was like a non-required course. And so then my mind would kind of wander in that direction. Of course, come back to where it was supposed to be, but it happens a lot.
Was it Einstein or was it some other great thinker who pointed out how imagination is almost more important than knowledge, than the actual practical knowledge, the ability to imagine solutions or even hypothesize, which is probably another way of saying imagine theories for the spread of life throughout the universe, if that's in fact what's happened, things like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, totally. And I'm not sure if that was Einstein that says that or that said that, but I would believe it. He has a lot of amazing quotes.
And some pretty rad hair.
And rad hair and rad slippers. There is an image online that he has like these giant fuzzy slippers, and I just kind of want to like touch them. Anyway, it kind of looks like his hair, actually. Yeah, I'll find it, I'll show you.
Well, but long ago in a galaxy far, far away at the beginning of our conversation, I said there were two things that your background brought up. And to recap for those that are still with us, the second part was this term exoplanet. Now, for those that have very high levels of space nerd cred, they're going to know what that means. But you're throwing out exoplaneteer and exoplanet like everybody knows what that's about. What is an exoplanet?
So an exoplanet is a planet, like a planet in our own solar system, except it has a system of its own. So these planets orbit stars outside of our solar system.
Oh.
And we know that they're there by a few different methods. There's the wobble method, that you can take a look at a star in space and it will move back and forth just a little bit due to the gravitational effect on the planet orbiting the star. So you can't really see the planet, but you know it's there. Another way to indirectly observe an exoplanet would be the transit method, which is what I primarily do in my own research. And the transit method is where the planet orbits its host star in our line of sight. So it goes between its star and the Earth, and when it passes in front, it blocks out a little bit of light from the star. And we can, with enough precision, enough sensitivity to the light coming from the star, that we could see that dip. And so if we measure how long the dip is and how deep the dip is, we can discover a little bit about what the planet is like. And so that's, and even knowing it's there in the first place, that's pretty important too. It's the main type of observations that the Kepler spacecraft did when it wasn't injured.
Mm. And that's personally fascinating to me. This is all, at least in the scale of human existence, this is all incredibly new, where we've gone from theories that exoplanets ought to exist to being able to verify not just the first one, but what the list is it thousands now or is it just hundreds?
It's in the thousands of exoplanet candidates. Or actually, I think it's confirmed exoplanets now. Kepler just came out with a huge number. They were able to reduce the data, which is bring out signals in the data that were indicative of exoplanets much more easily with a new method, because they have years of data that they need to sort through and say, this star here has an exoplanet, this star here doesn't, which is actually much harder to do than it sounds. So it's really great that we actually have so many candidates to follow up on, which is the point. We want to confirm whether or not these signals that we see are the planets. And this is a really new area of research, at least in astronomy. There's many different topics in astronomy. It's not just one, it's not one thing. And I think I recall that in the 90s was when exoplanet research really took off. And several years down the road, here we are with this gigantic list. And we're at the point now where we can even take pictures of the planet itself. It's really hard, but we can actually directly image them with adaptive optics and with the new telescopes coming up in the near future, near as in like several years, but near enough future, we can take even more images more easily with those telescopes. So it's really exciting. It's an exciting time.
Oh, it's incredibly exciting. I think that's a great opportunity for us to take a very quick break, and we'll come back after the break and speak just a little bit more about where exoplanet research is going in the near term with astronomer Lauren Biddle. Stay with us, and we'll be back in just a moment. Welcome back to Act 2 of our first hangout or live interview. Well, not so much live. Well, I'm alive. Lauren's alive. But we're actually recording this because we think the quality will be better rather than doing it through the internet thing. With astronomer Lauren Biddle. Welcome back, Lauren.
Hey.
And we were talking about exoplanets and their discovery before we went to the break. It seems to me that none of these exoplanets look very much like Earth or Tatooine, for that matter. Why is it that so far we haven't been finding any other pale blue dots? And are we likely to find pale blue dots in the future?
Okay. So, typically, the exoplanets that you hear about, or the ones that we can characterize the best, are larger ones. They're Jovian planets. They're large gas giants. And the reason simply being is they're just easier to detect. It doesn't mean that there aren't any rocky Earth-like planets out there. It's what we call an observational bias. We only hear about the big ones because those are the ones we can measure. Luckily, though, over time that we've been able to characterize smaller and smaller planets, there are some super Earths that we can see and some Earth-like planets, maybe not exactly Earth's radius, but we're getting there, certainly. And we mentioned earlier the telescopes that are up and coming. That was in correlation with the direct imaging comment. It's going to be really great to use those large collecting areas of the gigantic mirrors. It's the 30-meter telescope I know is one coming up, and then there's the Giant Magellan Telescope as well, the two that come to mind right away. And those will help us tremendously be able to characterize smaller and smaller exoplanets. And eventually, we can maybe find Earth 2.0, which would be rad. And also, not only those ground-based telescopes, but JWST, the James Webb Space Telescope, will help us characterize smaller and smaller planets' atmospheres in the infrared. So it's where we're going. I think within our lifetime, we'll find an Earth-like planet around a G-type star, which is like the Sun, which is, we want to find us. And maybe right. It would be cool if we could find like biosignatures in the atmospheres. And these are the telescopes and instruments that can help.
You mentioned that a lot of these new telescopes are ground-based. That seems to a non-astronomer to be kind of counterintuitive, that they'd be looking for something that's so hard to detect through the diffusion, for lack of a better way of describing it, of the Earth's atmosphere. It would seem like all the emphasis and effort should be placed on building new space-based telescopes like the James Webb Space Telescope that you mentioned. Why are we looking from the bottom of the fishbowl, as some like to describe that process?
That's a great question. So that's a great question. The adaptive optics I had mentioned earlier helps us to see through the atmosphere with as little distortion as possible. So we call that seeing. And seeing is
high-tech.
Yeah, the distortion of light as it passes through the atmosphere. It kind of jumps around a little bit, and it makes it so we can't observe objects with as high precision. Luckily, with deformable mirrors, there's a secondary... the deformable mirrors, they can have little teeny actuators on the backside. And what they do is they pulse like 1,000, some ridiculous number times a second. And they use the laser to send the information of the light wavefront to the telescope before, just in time so that it can correct for any distortion that the atmosphere causes. So it's almost like you're in space. The differences are there's still like absorption from certain wavelengths in our atmosphere. So say you're going to do spectroscopy and you wanted to look at a certain wavelength of light, you can't do it as easily on the surface as you could in space just because the atmosphere is there even AO adaptive optics wouldn't help with that at all. So there's definitely these limitations, but with where we're going, it's getting more and more plausible to make amazing observations with large aperture telescopes on the ground and not only in space. Now, doesn't mean that we don't need space-based telescopes. So we definitely do. They're very useful because there's, like I said earlier, there are objects and science that can't be done on the ground.
So if I understand you correctly, what you're saying is that in this context of planet hunting, of being an exoplaneteer, because of the cost and complexity of building very large structures in space, we make the compromise of being below or at the bottom of the Earth's atmosphere and taking advantage of adaptive optics in order to be able to build something of at least sufficient scale that we can do the work that we need to do, at least until such time as we can build, because of commercialization of space activity, these very large structures in outer space or in near Earth space in the future. Is that kind of what I hear you saying?
Yeah. And it's also...
Don't get all complex on me with your answers.
It's also a lot easier to fix things when they're down here. And space-based telescopes are quite expensive, and it's a big risk as well. I know JWST will be located, when it's in orbit, in a position around the Earth that we can't get to fix it. And so if anything goes wrong, it's kind of like, oh, well... So that's why we have the best working on it, and so to avoid that situation altogether. But I know even like with Hubble, it needs glasses. when we first put Hubble into orbit, we took images with it. It wasn't nearly as clear as we had anticipated. And it turns out that the mirror wasn't perfect. There was a mistake. And so we were able to send up something to correct it. And so now everyone who's seen Hubble images knows that they are absolutely phenomenal images, and we can take phenomenal data and do amazing science with it. All these like big words, phenomenal, amazing, but it really describes the whole situation, at least to me. So it's really cool that we can access that, but it's a lot easier to fix something on the ground if it goes wrong. So it's a risk, it's expensive, but it's worth it.
Sure, sure. Well, and on the ground, you've got obviously more power available for the subsystems to operate your telescope and processing systems. And I'm guessing that it's easier to get to your local Starbucks, et cetera, for those all-night observing sessions as well.
Oh, if only Starbucks was open at night or at 3 a.m. Actually, I bet you somewhere out there that there's people up enough at night that they need Starbucks at 3 a.m. and it's available. Anyway, beside the point. Coffee in general, caffeine, yes. Availability, space.
No. Is that one of the fuels of modern astronomical discovery for at least a telescope operator?
Caffeine? Yes. Yeah, caffeine is a lifesaver. I hate to be so dependent on caffeine. I know on my Twitter description it says caffeine keeps me alive, and that's not too much of an overstatement. I think that there have been some points where it's like 4:30 in the morning, and we on day one is actually the hardest, or night one out of however many nights, because that you're getting used to being up at night. You're not in nocturnal mode yet, but it's the coffee is definitely helps out a lot, and yeah.
What were some of your childhood and maybe adolescent scientific inspirations and things that got you sort of focused, slewed your telescope, so to speak, in the direction of astronomy and discovery?
Oh, I like talking about that. I'm happy you asked. So my first real experience with anything not on this earth was when I was in Florida with my papa, which is my mom's dad, so my grandpa. I could just call him papa. He had a really small telescope. I think it was the lens was only a couple inches in diameter, which is, I mean, any telescope's awesome, and you can still see great things with it, which is why it's made such an impact on my life. And it was very dark out. We went out to the beach, and there was a lunar eclipse that night, and I didn't know what that was, and he had to explain to me what it was. And I took a look through the telescope at the lunar eclipse, and I was like 6 at the time, and I remember it so perfectly, like the emotion that, like, words don't even, that was the moment where I was like, space is real. It exists, and I like it. However, I didn't really know that it was something that I wanted to pursue as a career until high school. Before that, I wanted to be a marine biologist really bad. I know everything there is to know about sharks. Well, not everything there is to know, obviously. I know a lot, a significant amount about sharks. So maybe someday we can talk about sharks. That'd be really cool.
Sharks in space. I think with Sharknado, that actually has happened.
Sharknado. Actually, I've seen Sharknado 1, but I haven't seen Sharknado 2, the second one.
There were so many unanswered questions, they had to make Sharknado 2.
Oh, yeah, certainly.
No idea.
I'm actually, maybe I'll watch that tonight. Put that on my to-do list. Anyway, senior year, that was the first time that I had actually tried astrophotography. I took a class in high school that was only available to seniors, and it was an astronomy class. We had 8-inch telescopes that we could take out at night. We held class at night as well. Class was held at like 10 p.m., and it was freezing. It was like 1 degree. I'm from somewhere really cold. And, it can get really cold. And I wasn't even that unhappy. I wasn't unhappy to be out there. I remember looking at the first object that wasn't the moon that I had looked through with a telescope at. It was the Orion Nebula, and I think my mind was absolutely blown to pieces about the fact that the photons, the actual photons of light, passed through the telescope and went to my eye and were registered by my brain. Like, that actually happened. It was an actual, it's not a picture. And that really hit me. And I think I was like, hey, this is really cool. This is something I want to maybe look into more. And it made it easier that, I liked astronomy anyway. And I had always liked astronomy. I think in third grade, I remember deciding Saturn was my favorite planet. So I kind of had like favorite astronomy things anyway. So I was like, I'll give it a shot. And I'm glad I did.
That is a great story. And it, I think, actually kind of leads us into a natural transition when we come back from our second and final break in this approximately half hour show to talk to Astro Lauren Biddle, astronomer, about kind of the pathway into astronomy school and the way to grow and develop along with more experienced peers, either in astronomy or in other aspects of science. So more with Lauren Biddle when we come back in just a moment. If you're enjoying this video and wish to support our work, bringing you the excitement, awe, and outright wonder of aviation, space exploration, and science, please visit AeroSpaceNews.com/fanfunding and make any contribution you can afford. There, you'll also find exclusive, cool stuff whose purchase helps us produce new videos and stories from the leading edge. When you like our videos, share them, and subscribe to our channel, it's another way to lend a hand that's absolutely free. Please, support us today. Thank you. We're back with astronomer Lauren Biddle, our very own Astro Lauren, as I like to call her. Lauren, thanks for sticking with us.
Yeah, no problem.
Before the break, we were talking about kind of the very beginning inspiration for your path into the or out to the stars. And I'm just wondering, as a kid, I think I've already bored you with this story off camera. I was inspired to get into documentary filmmaking and specifically in the world of science and the planet and biology and all that by the late, great Jacques Cousteau. Was there any sort of television programming or people like that that got you started or played a role in inspiring you to get into science in any facet or form or into astronomy?
Well, I had actually, as a child, never really watched any science shows that were specific to astronomy and astronomy topics. I do know that many people have the experience of watching Carl Sagan's Cosmos, and that's something that I wish that I would have picked up a little sooner. I have been able to watch some of Cosmos by Carl Sagan, and he is a role model to me and as a scientist and as a science communicator as well. I think he's really great. But before that, I had the Discovery Channel, Animal Planet. Oh, I was all over it. My first science television series experience was about scorpions. Actually, I remember that day, and I thought they were so. They weren't even like about sharks or anything. But I remember thinking like, this is so scary, but so cool. And ever since then, I had watched Animal Planet all the time. So and Discovery Channel too. So that those are sciencey things that had solidified my interest in science in general.
Did any of the movies that were out before you were born, or like the original Star Wars, or TV shows that were non-scientific, that were works of fiction or speculative fiction, did they inspire you? Star Wars versus Star Trek? Where do you come down on that dividing line?
Ooh. Oh man. Okay, so I'm gonna get so much grief from the audience from the well, I don't know, depending on Star Wars versus Star Trek. I love Star Wars a lot. At one point in my life, I was a Queen Amidala even for Halloween, and I was also Padme in college at one point. For Halloween, and I would always dress like them, and I'd read all the books, and I'd watch all the movies over and over again, and I loved the sci-fi aspect, obviously science fiction. I knew that something like that wasn't real, but the idea that, this is going to sound kind of repetitive, the idea that the idea can exist was really cool to me, and I would totally be a Jedi if I could. Actually, let me even rephrase that. When I graduated, or when all the science, College of Science people graduated from the university with our degrees, we got to say a quote. And my quote was, could have been a Jedi. Got a laugh. I was kind of proud of myself for that one. But in all seriousness, like, if I could be a Jedi, I totally would. So there's that. Now, I have to say, I'm not anti-Star Trek. I just don't know as much about it. So maybe I could do a little homework and get up to date on the Star Trek, and then we'll come back to this. Stay tuned.
Well, here at AeroSpaceNews.com, we're an equal opportunity sci-fi nerd. Definitely love both the Star Trek and the sci-fi, Star Wars, I should say, universe. Perhaps biased in some part because I grew up watching Star Trek, the TV show, on Kinescope. Look it up. But I definitely love Star Wars myself. Love all the nerd specifics you dropped just then. Says very good things about you. And, you know, I think, if I'm not mistaken, in the last calendar year or so, did we not spot an exoplanet that had twin suns like Tatooine in the first movie?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think there may be more than just one system that this was identified, this type of system. It's a binary star system, and the planet orbits both of them. And so you would have two stars, which is very much like Tatooine. And it's kind of a joke between exoplanet astronomers to include a famous picture of Luke Skywalker walking on Tatooine with both setting suns. And we have those in like slides and posters, and it gets a good chuckle every time. And I think that was Kepler. It had identified one or more of those kind of systems. So it was cool to kind of nerd out on that as well. We get a little extra giddy from it. Relate it's actually real in a sense. Now hopefully there's like an Earth-like planet. That'd be cool. But just the fact they exist anyway is pretty rad.
Yeah, for sure. But maybe with a little more water than Tatooine. That was a little dusty.
Yeah, just a bit.
Could use a fan. On the subject of Carl Sagan, obviously Cosmos got a reboot with the great, great Neil deGrasse Tyson hosting it, and among other people producing, the fabulous Seth MacFarlane has helped make that show a more modern reality. Are you getting to watch any of Cosmos, the Next Generation, for lack of a better way of describing it?
Oh, I wouldn't miss it. No way. I was like all over that. I haven't had like a party at home. We had like a Cosmos viewing party. It was great.
Oh, outstanding. I personally was moved by or struck by the very first episode where in a way that seemed like a very sincerely felt tribute, Tyson took a moment to sort of go about passing the baton from Carl Sagan's version to his own near the end of that episode. And he spoke about the time that he was fortunate enough to be a guest of Carl Sagan's and visit his office on a weekend. Did you get a chance to see that part?
Oh, yeah. And I may or may not have shed a tear or seven or more. That was really touching. And I think especially as a developing astronomer, and, you know, I know that I don't know everything. I'm not claiming to know everything. And I know that I'm still learning. To see that kind of leadership and to have a role model like either Carl Sagan or Neil deGrasse Tyson, or I guess Carl Sagan as Neil deGrasse Tyson's role model, and seeing where he has developed as a person as well as a scientist, it was very touching. I was very happy.
Have you had any experiences that were similar to that as you've attended your professional gatherings and trade events and research exhibitions and things like that?
Yeah, and I think that as someone who is just learning about a certain topic, or it doesn't even have to be astronomy or physics, or it could be anything in general, if you're learning about a subject and you're around people who are very much more experienced, I think it's common for us to be afraid to ask questions or to be afraid to admit that you don't know everything. You don't want to be viewed as like stupid or anything, even not that people would do that, but it's just, I think it's natural to be afraid of something like that. And I've had amazing role models within my undergrad and people that I really look up to who have helped me overcome first, the fear of feeling stupid, even though, I mean, I know I'm we're people in general, we're just not, I mean, we're not stupid, really. I mean, no one else thinks like, oh, wow, what a stupid question. I think one of the greatest achievements that I've actually obtained as an undergrad was being able to ask questions and knowing what questions to ask and having those there to answer and help me ask in the first place. I think that's something we could all take from this.
It's important to ask why, ask how, and to have people as generous with their time. And folks, let me just, if you haven't seen that episode of Cosmos, I don't know if it's available on Netflix or from other sources, but definitely go back and try and watch it and watch Neil deGrasse Tyson tell that story of how generous and kind Carl Sagan was to him on that day and how it informed the kind of man that Neil deGrasse Tyson wanted to be. And without getting into any boring details, long before that TV show aired, I had an occasion to have to call on by telephone Neil deGrasse Tyson. And he was uncommonly kind and generous to me on the telephone. And he did everything that he spoke about doing years later on that TV show. And I would hope that we would all treat other people in our lives the same way. Ask the mentors in your life, the more experienced people, questions, and I hope that you're lucky enough to get them to answer your questions and be patient with you. But the worst they can say is no, so don't be afraid to ask. Do ask. Speaking of questions, Lima Bravo, Lauren Biddle, should people feel brave enough to ask you questions?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I hope you ask me questions. I would love to answer them. And even if they're questions, actually, I almost hope that they're questions that I don't know the answer to right away, because then that means that I get to learn too. if you can comment below, ask any question you want about astronomy, science, and I'd love to discuss it on a video with you guys.
Now, just to be clear and set your expectations, if there's 10,000 questions for Lauren, obviously we won't have the time in the channel to answer every single one of them. But if you do have a question, none are too rudimentary or basic about science or astronomy or how to go about finding a place to study astronomy in school or news from recent discoveries. Between Lauren and I can tell you we would love to have you ask those questions. And as she said, leave a comment below. You can also leave comments over on our site at AeroSpaceNews.com, but it's probably a little more compact to put them right here on the video, because Lauren has so generously agreed to come back, I hope, right, and visit with us in future episodes, I hope many, many, many more, on a pretty frequent basis. So did I get that right, Lauren? Are you coming back? Or
oh, totally.
Have I worn out my welcome?
Yep, coming back. This was fun.
Score. So please leave a comment. We're going to talk to Lauren in the future about breaking news, just about what it's the work of being an exoplaneteer, what it's like to continue her academic career, and all that other kind of fun stuff. Lots of goodness, lots of Astro Lauren goodness coming up. I'm going to put on screen right about now or at some point not too long after this where you can find Lauren on Twitter, so that you could read her informative and fun and sometimes just amusing tweets. And of course, to really keep up with where she is, at least for now, subscribe to our YouTube channel so that you can see her in upcoming episodes and hopefully some other stuff that's worth your while watching too. So I think that kind of wraps this episode up. It's our first Hangout or live interview. I could not ask for a more generous and wonderful person to interview for this first time. Astronomer Lauren Biddle, thank you again for joining us.
Thanks for having me. And this was such a fun experience, and I'm really looking forward to all the new videos that we have and all the new topics especially. It was just a great time. Thank you.
Well, it's absolutely been my pleasure. Everybody, we'll see you again next time. Again, remember to subscribe, and that's it for now. If you're enjoying this video and wish to support our work, bringing you the excitement, awe, and outright wonder of aviation, space exploration, and science, please visit AeroSpaceNews.com/fanfunding and make any contribution you can afford. There, you'll also find exclusive cool stuff whose purchase helps us produce new videos and stories from the leading edge. When you like our videos, share them, and subscribe to our channel, it's another way to lend a hand that's absolutely free. Please support us today. Thank you.